upcoming events. On the 15th of April, there's a seminar on Tuesday, that's 3 p.m., Professor Velayatham Sarvanam, Land Acquisition Act in India, Impact on Environment and Livelihood Lecture by Professor Kansha Ilaya, is Production Pollution, Interrogating Spiritual Justice. Then 17th April, there is a public lecture by Ms. Madhavi Desai on Women in the City, the case of Ahmedabad. On the 19th, there is a workshop on Nehru's World, and the participants are Dr. Chandrasekhar Dasgupta, Dr. Pallavi Raghavan, Dr. C. Rajamohan, Mr. Shiv Shankar Menon, the National Security Advisor, and Dr. Srinath Raghavan. Those are the forthcoming events. There are some papers which have been, occasional papers which have been published by NMML recently. One is by K. Satyanarayana, Politics of Caste and Identity in Contemporary South India. Another is by Anuradha Kalhan, The Possibility of Stimulating Inclusive Growth. The third is by Narendra Shukla, Bharatiya Swatantrata Andolan or Patipandit Sahitya. These are available outside at nominal prices, along with other papers published earlier. There's a website of the Nehru Memorial Museum, which you're all aware of, I suppose. Now to today's lecture, it is by Professor Rita Kothari from the Indian Institute of Technology, Ahmedabad. She has done a lot of work on language partition, especially focused on Sindh and Kutch. I won't detain you for long. She will be speaking on questions in and of language. So let's go straight to her.
Sure.
And then I think she will speak for about 50 minutes, and then there will be questions and answers.
Thank you so much. Do we need the microphone? Okay.
It's useful because it's being recorded.
Oh, yeah, that's right. I sort of bring to you the freshness of raw research or rawness of fresh research, questions of multilingualism and translation that I'm sort of deeply engaged in and have been for a long time, except that now I'm sort of beginning to think of them afresh, unlearning some of the things that I have learned over these years about language and about translation and meaning making. And it is in that context that I bring to you some of the very recent work I did. I used this as an opportunity to spur myself to sort of think more carefully about at least the languages that I have worked with before going on to something much larger. And it is in that context that I bring to you the case of Gujarati. So let me begin, because there is... I might sort of run out of time, in which case I'll just quickly begin to summarize some of the positions and arguments I have here. Sorat gad sun utri, jhanjar re jhankar, dhruje gadare kangra, haare hame dhruje to gad girnar re. In English, this means, as Sorat stepped out of the fort, not only the hill in the neighborhood, but the walls of Girnar Fort trembled by the sweet twinkle of her toe bells. This verse is one from amongst a vast repertoire of the narrative traditions of the musician community of Langhas. The story and its various versions and recitations have elements from Sindhi, Marwari, Gujarati, and dialectical inflections from all three, pointing to its mobility in Saurashtra, Kutch, Sindh, and parts of Rajasthan, regions that show with varying intensities many threads of continuity. If the story of King Diyaj and his infatuation for Sorat has traveled, so have the Langhas and other tribes who carried the story with them. King Diyaj hailed from Sindh and belonged to the tribe of the Samas who ruled Kutch and Saurashtra. It is possible that the story traveled with the Samas, who recreated through its dissemination the glorious sacrifice of King Diyaj, Also Shah Abdul Latif, the famous 16th century Sufi of Sindh, traveled the entire western part of the subcontinent, and his popularization of these folk tales has contributed immensely to the sustenance of narrative traditions. The verse and translation are both recorded in Rajasthan. Circularities of this nature dislodge the notion of what is called source in translation studies and thereby language. And I wish us to keep this philosophical background in mind before we proceed. Thus, the assumption that languages are given, fully formed, well-defined, and discrete entities erroneously informs a range of contemporary discourses on nationalism, identity, textual practices, and discussions of translation, the last being the vantage point I come from. The edifice of language is more often than not invisible, a background that on occasions gets foregrounded in intense and violent ways. How does language become both an argument and its ally in the service of state, territory, nation, citizenship, and a host of so-called larger causes? How do its operation and constructed genealogies erase and diminish histories and memories, turn certain identities illegitimate, outsider alike? How does language get deployed to mark out differences and also to homogenize them? And what rhetoric is employed in such situations? And how do we examine language as the thing itself, as well as a metaphor? This inquiry must be made with interdisciplinary approaches that are sensitive to language as cultural memory, as well as practice, rather than disembodied objects of linguistic inquiry or instruments of policy and politics. How do we incorporate, along with prisms of religion, caste, and community, the idea of language and complicate our understanding of regions, nations, and citizenships? How are communities imagined through language, as scholars such as Sumathi Ramaswamy and Lisa Michel remind us, with respect to Tamil and Telugu respectively? The specificity of questions I ask come from a simultaneous engagement with ethnography and translation, or rather ethnography as translation. Practices of language and meaning-making in everyday India, especially in overtly performative contexts, but more so in unself-conscious contexts, take place in ways that have not been theorized. As for the larger centrality of languages in shaping territories, Asha Sarangi's work is pioneering. Her critique of enumeration technologies and their role in shaping ethno-linguistic identities is important, and I have benefited greatly from her work. However, studies on multilingualism and how that operates on the ground are yet to be written. Languages comprehensible to each other get politically divided, and sometimes incomprehensible ones get clubbed as one language. Hegemonic languages shrink multilinguality, while minor ones stretch themselves, sometimes to the point of relinquishing the places they come from. Complicating this crisscrossing, relations that are both temporally and spatially, and horizontally and vertically determined, is the presence of English, a subject that demands its own treatment, and yet never, as the case tends to be, without its relationality with other Indian languages. In the course of fieldwork carried out in the Western region over years, and also close observations of the practices of language, I find it increasingly bewildering to think of texts, and I'm using this in an expansive manner, as binaries of sources and targets. Sources are protean, many-faced, formed through languages, translation constituting them rather than being corollaries to the process. While we may recognize this, this knowledge seldom informs scholarship. Uncovering assumptions that go into the making of a language reveal anxieties and desires of history and identity in particular directions. If historians will not study this and linguists will not study history, we can continue living with a schism of histories of people without knowing how they express themselves, and books on languages that tell us nothing of those that shaped historical moments. For instance, scholars working on Gujarat seldom see that in order to break the monolith of so-called Muslim identity in Gujarat, it is important to see how linguistically heterogeneous Muslims are and how those histories of language and mobility shape identities in specific and non-summarizable ways. For instance, a recent novel in Gujarati called Vaad, which I've been translating, shows a UP Muslim speaking Urdu while the one from Gujarat speaks Gujarati. A neutral fact by itself, except that the Muslim from Uttar Pradesh is also involved in a terrorist project and indoctrinates the Gujarati-speaking, rather gullible Muslim from Gujarat who switches over to Ammi and Abba from Ba and Bapu as he gets close to the Muslim from UP. The externalization of Urdu, its synonymy with a specific group, creates an erroneous sociology because it assumes that identities are monolingually formed or that correspondence between language and identity is linear and consistent. I hope to demonstrate this through the case of Gujarati, and I make three overlapping arguments here. One, that G.A. Grierson's Linguistic Survey of India, cultural nationalism of the kind articulated by K.M. Munshi, and the formation of the linguistic state contribute to the consolidation of, within quotes, Gujarati. Assumptions of fixed origins, indigeneity, timelessness, and exclusion written into the exercise. And yet close readings of these texts betray effort and anxiety in these positions. My second point is that nations are founded upon forgetting, a fact well known and documented by now. The forgotten or neglected episode of Arabic, Persian, and later the existence of Gujri, a patwa emerging out of social, devotional, and economic transactions around the 16th century, point to the presence of a schism in the midst of pluralism and demands a revision of some positions on Gujarat. Sustained and profuse presence of Arabic and Persian get reduced through rhetorical operations to clinical and reductive notions of what is called borrowing and loan words. At a linguistic level, this is done through a separation of syntax and vocabulary, but in terms of cultural history, such a separation by reducing rich lived lives ignores the fact that they are constitutive contexts shaping history and identity. My third point is that an extremely complex linguistic terrain lies beyond the official and obvious sites of Gujarati. Different and non-standard varieties of language continue to be spoken and also serve as indices of location, caste, and community. Gujaratis spoken by the tribals, Muslims, Dalits are many and disrupt the coherent narrative of Gujarati. So does Kachhi, a lingering reminder of homogenization of the state. Yet a dynamism characterizes this terrain so that certain linguistic identities are steadfastly held, some morphed if not abdicated, and some steering clear by aspiring for an allegedly neutral language like English. So let me begin with my first section. In a classic of Gujarati literature titled Bhadram Bhadra, which has not been yet translated, written in the early 20th century by author Raman Bhai Neelkanth, the protagonist Daulat Shankar travels from Ahmedabad to Mumbai. Exasperated and enraged by the Sudharaks, social reformers, who were bent upon reforming the time-tested Sanatan Dharma, Daulat Shankar has resolved to defeat them in a debate to be held in Mumbai, a significant center of social reform in the Bombay Presidency in the 19th and early 20th century. Daulat Shankar buys two tickets for himself and his companion at the railway station and utters words that are indelibly marked among readers of Gujarati literature. He says, "Mohanagari mate me mulya patrika aapsho." That is to say, give me two tickets to go to Mumbai. Very obviously, he is not understood. At the ticket counter is a Parsi whose Gujarati is very different from Daulat Shankar's. "Shubha kech," exclaims the Parsi clerk. Daulat Shankar has no patience with such corrupt language and impure humanity. He's a Don Quixote of his time, expecting a purer world out there that simply needed reclaiming. The moving train rocks him to sleep, but only to dream a frightening dream. Lord Shiva appears before him and rebukes him of using his name Shankar along with a Yavani foreign word Daulat. A chastised Daulat Shankar renames himself and is now Badram Badra, an immortal entity in Gujarati literature, amusing and parodic, but with lessons important for all times. Although Raman Bhai Neelkant's objects of opposition were the Brahmin scholars of his time, the novel is an important comment on all willful erasures of histories and cultural encounters. It is not pertinent at this stage to demonstrate how Badram Badra's agenda of purifying language, history, culture, past and present remain implausible, drawing him into a neurotic chaos. The comic spirit of the novel cannot and should not be subjected to the verbosity of critical labels and is perhaps left alone at this stage. What Badram Badra tells us is that not only are purification rites comic, but fashioning an identity begins with language, and yet it's never entirely about language. The irony, ambivalence, and complexity of this understanding in a piece of fiction more than a century ago is strangely missing from the earnest valorization and unquestioned view of Gujarati language today. The memory of this novel was triggered off by a recent event, the Gujarati Literature Festival held in Ahmedabad from 3rd to 5th January 2014. The organizers announced the need to recognize that the youth would appreciate and relate with the language if we, and again in quotes, allow English words. The festival's use and validation of social media, Gujarati films, television serials, mixture of forms and languages, publicized its contemporary and open outlook in a neoliberal market and a state that wishes for both globalization as well as region language-based identity. It is a different matter that the festival was almost entirely adorned with, organized and attended by upper caste, to a large extent upper class, Hindus speaking in Gujarati. A Dalit writer, Dalpat Chauhan, asked a question on dialectical forms of Gujarati but was laughed out of court. The certainty about what Gujarati is remained intact, its universality remained unchallenged, for there were no writers from Kutchi or from linguistic minorities such as Sindhi and Urdu. To the organizers of this festival, and this would be true of for any other literary event in Gujarat, the idea that what we know as Gujarati today was one of the many possibilities created out of a historical melting pot is an alien one. So how have we come to be where we are? Deluded into believing that Gujarati is timeless, universal, and benignly available or desirable to one and all? And what exactly is Gujarati, apart from being the official language of Gujarat since it became a linguistic state in 1960, and the supposed nucleus of what appears in popular imagination as a given Gujarati identity? How did it become a political boundary and a source of social and cultural power? What are its origins? When did Gujarati become settled, its rough edges smoothened, its certitudes of being the language of one and all in the territory of Gujarat formed, the confidence of being inclusive of all taken for granted? The present moment, at least from appearance of things, might appear to be one such. And I wish to draw your attention to three events or moments in the past that may have contributed to it. So in the discussion that follows, I show both the building and the attendant, sometimes unnoticed struggle, of a coherent narrative of Gujarati. Some of the myth-making is traceable, and the discussion maps these in three stages of language-making, history-making, and region-making. And the first stage I begin, not in a very linear manner, with Munshi, K.M. Munshi. The section is called Origin, Indigeneity, Exclusion, questioning Munshi's claim. And I begin by quoting Gandhi, who says, "Gujarat, like the rest of India, is brooding. The language is shaping itself." At a time when K.M. Munshi, one of the most influential nationalist figures from Gujarat, documented a history of Gujarati literature, it is odd for Gandhi to mention in a foreword to such a history the language was shaping itself. Histories of literature are written upon certainties of language. Why would Gandhi do that? From Gandhi's point of view, the first dictionary of Gujarati language, Sarth Jodani Kosh, was in the process of taking shape under his own leadership at the Gujarat Vidyapeeth. Considered to be the first modern writer, Narmad was still writing in a style that would appear Parsi Gujarati to a contemporary reader and so distant from the formal Sanskritized Gujarati that characterizes our times. Gandhi also noticed the absence of Muslims and Parsis as partakers of Gujarati literature in Munshi's history, a fact he gently pointed out in the foreword. The writers Munshi included were also from the upper class, what Gandhi called commercially minded. He lamented the chasm between us, the middle class, and those whose language we do not even follow. It is clear then that the unsettled nature of Gujarati made Gandhi say in the foreword to Gujarati and its literature that the language was shaping itself. Gandhi's foreword betrays an unfortunate and uneasy relation with Munshi's text, a matter strangely undiscussed in circles of Gujarati literature. The valorization of Munshi and non-serious engagement with Gandhi may have something to do with it. Setting that aside, let me turn to what Munshi has to say about the Gujarati language. Munshi's view on Gujarati sculpts the definition of a national history. He says, and I quote, "Like other units of India distinguished by the dominance of a single individual, Gujarat had an independent social and cultural entity from the earliest times. Each of such province possessed a common stock of traditions and values and social outlook which was set working by the early Aryans in India and developed during the course of history peculiar to itself. All of them have employed and do employ now the structure, wealth and tradition of Sanskrit for their fuller literary expression. They all throb with common ideals and cherish a common will," unquote. Jayant Kothari, in his account of the evolution of the language, mentions that to look for an origin of a language is like asking where a river originated. Prior to Premanand and Bhalan in the 16th century, poets referred to their own language as Prakrit. He assures us that we can rejoice in the knowledge that the Apabhransh in the 12th century, in the works of Vajsen and Shailabhadra, and even in spoken language, perhaps had elements that we now recognize as Gujarati. According to him, the emergence of Gujarati can be put down to a period between the 10th and 12th centuries. This view is formed by the claim that Munshi makes, which is that Gujarat, the Chalukya dynasty that ruled Gujarat from 942 to 1299 AD, was a linguistically cohesive region. If Bhalan in the 16th century and Premanand later were perhaps the first ones to refer to their language as Gujarati and their predecessors referred to their own language as Prakrit, self-definition alone would make Munshi's claim a weak one. And yet every history of Gujarati literature and language builds up on Munshi's view that the present-day Gujarat was formed under the Hindu dynasty of the Solankis. We must also remember that the boundaries of the kingdom of the Chalukya or the Solanki dynasty were different from present-day territory. The Gurjars, a pastoralist group that supposedly lent its name to the region, have inhabited at different times Punjab, Rajputana, Madhya Pradesh. Even when Sidra Jai Singh, considered to be the most glorious king of Gujarat, consolidated his reign, it included Gujarat, Rajputana and Malwa. Language, therefore, was created between Dwarka and Mathura. It included Marwari, Mewati, Jaipuri, Mewadi, and Malvi. What we consider as old Gujarati would also perhaps be old Rajasthani. It is also known as Western Rajasthani, although Uma Shankar Joshi calls it Maru Gurjar, and K.K. Shastri calls it Gurjar Bhasha. What we do know for certain is that something got created out of the mercantile, migrant, Jain merchants and monks, pastoralists and traders between Rajasthan and Gujarat. It would be fallacious of Gujarat as of any region to imagine an indigeneity of origins and history of language. Moreover, the Chalukya dynasty did not extend up to Kutch. a province with cultural distinctness and political autonomy of its own, at least most of the time. In fact, even in the 20th century, when Munshi was writing his various histories, Kutch was a princely state with a distinct language, history, and sovereignty of its own. Its connection with Gujarat did exist, but it was equally, if not, more connected with Sindh, a fact that Farhana Ibrahim and my recent work has shown. But Munshi's brisk dismissal, once again, is worth noting. He says, Kutch, for culture and literary purposes, has always been regarded as part of Gujarat. Now, who is the elliptical subject here? Regarded by whom? Who, according to Munshi, should be deciding to be the including or the obliging party? These are not questions that have somehow not been discussed at all, but we don't have the time to. And then he goes on to talk about north of Umbergaon. He says Gujarati is spoken by all classes. And note his words. He says, the people understand Marathi and use a good many Marathi words, but the bulk of the vocabulary and the grammar is Gujarati. And then he says, south, as far as Vaitarana, between the coast and the railway, the language of almost all classes, except Maratha Brahmins and other late immigrants, is also Gujarati, rather than Marathi. And along the Danu coast, where Gujarati is taught in the government schools, the Gujarati element is so strong as to make ordinary speech unintelligible to anyone who knows Marathi only. What was Munshi's basis for saying the above? Would the Maharashtra side of story say the same thing or construct another narrative? These positions have not found in Gujarat an internal critique, but Munshi's broader positions have come to be challenged in recent times in English language scholarship. Its ramifications are yet to be felt in the literary circles of Gujarat. For instance, Sitanshu Yashaschandra, who goes on to critique Munshi, and he says that Munshi uses stable signifiers like region and language, really speaking, in order to further a very clear socio-political agenda of his own time. And a very systematic critique of Munshi's claims comes in this recent book by Samira Sheikh called Forging the Region, which perhaps you would be aware of. And so Samira sort of argues that it is after the Chalukya period, after the taking over of Gujarat by Alauddin Khilji to the end of the Mughals in Gujarat, she says there is a period when a forging of a certain Indo-vernacular polity takes place. And she looks at this as a kind of a marketplace, as a site of transactions where peers and sultans and travelers and pastoralists and traders were interacting for practices of economy or devotion with several languages, Sanskrit and Apabhramsha and Arabic and Persian and so on, leading also to the build-up of a patwa that I mentioned, and if I have time I'll talk more about it, of something called Gujari. Munshi, by the way, is drawing his classification from Grierson, a very influential figure in the histories to follow. By itself, Grierson's Linguistic Survey of India would have been a fairly insubstantial text, despite an enormous ethnographic richness of language variation recorded by him. I have discussed elsewhere that Grierson was employing translation to distinguish different varieties of language, but I also argue that Grierson's Linguistic Survey of India is by itself an act of translation, and if there is time, I'll elaborate on that. But I think, before me, Asha Sarangi remarks that Grierson's appreciation for people's languages and tongues was Herderian in spirit, which looked for an isomorphic relationship between languages and culture. Also, hierarchies of language and dialect introduced in the survey were foreign to the processes of linguistic thinking in India. However, Grierson was invoked by influential figures in Gujarat, as may have been the case elsewhere too. As far as Gujarati is concerned, he makes the following observations, and I'll go through these quickly. First, he begins his Gujarati section by saying, we can trace the old Vedic language through Prakrit down to Apabhramsh, and we can trace the development of Apabhramsh from the verses of Hemchandra down to the language of a Parsi newspaper. No single step is wanting. The line is complete for nearly 4,000 years. The second point he makes, he says Gujarati means the vernacular language of Gujarat, and this name very accurately connotes the area in which it is spoken. Please remember, this does not include Kutch. Rajasthani, he says, had to be invented to distinguish from Western Hindi on one hand and from Gujarati on the other. And then he goes on to say, Gujarat extends as far south as the southern border of the district of Surat, where it meets the Marathi of Daman. No mention of Portuguese, by the way. On both sides of the border line, the country is bilingual. The two nationalities, the Gujaratis and Marathis, are mixed, and each preserves its own tongue. Then Grierson says, most of the Muslims of Gujarat speak Hindustani, not Gujarati, and specimens of their language will be found in the section devoted to Western Hindi. Some tribes, however, are by origin descended from converted Hindus. They may speak Gujarati. The educated members of this class speak ordinary Gujarati with a free admission of Hindustani, and specimens of this form of speech are not necessary. The uneducated Gujarati-speaking Muslims usually employ the dialect of their uneducated neighbors. Grierson also makes equally dismissive remarks about Bhili, but I'm not sort of going into that. The indigeneity implied in Grierson's opening remarks on Gujarati sits strangely with his own observation that the curious mixture of races which now inhabits Gujarat, and even the name of the country, is derived from a foreign tribe who invaded it from the north and east, the Gurjaras. The Gurjaras, as I said, were a pastoralist group who inhabited Gujarat at different times. If Gujarat and Gujarati existed as stable signifiers for Grierson, it must be noted that it did not. Not only did it not include Kutch. In fact, Grierson goes on then to list the Scythians and the Yadavas and the Greeks and the Bactrians and the Parsis and the Dutch and the French and the British. To goes on to say that how does a region get formed out of such heterogeneous elements of population that we call Gujarati? And yet, he once again goes on to using the title word Gujarati in this completely stable manner. But I feel these kinds of close readings of Grierson, the contradictions that his own text sort of reveals to us, have sort of not been sufficiently looked at. Governed by the experiences of a monolingual world, Grierson interpreted languages as either one or the other. And his survey shows that languages were created, assimilated, written off, subsumed, and differentiated. So I'm sort of not going into his distinction of the Thari and the Rajasthani and what implications that have for Gujarati. But I want to end this particular section on Grierson by asking, as Shudipto Kaviraj does, where do languages begin and end, and how does one determine their boundaries? To what extent do identities of people and nations draw from languages? Kaviraj alerts us to the dangers of treating language as fully formed discrete entities. And in fact, Grierson's own cited difficulties in the linguistic survey of India shows us that it is a world, to put it dramatically, of transitions rather than of boundaries. Grierson's Gujarati section has been translated into Gujarati by again a very influential figure called Keka Shastri. My next section, which is also the third, if I may remind you, milestone, or the third myth-making process, is the formation of the linguistic state. The first one was Munshi, the second was Grierson, and the third is the state, which is formed in 1960. A year ago, approximately, when the Lok Sabha resonated with cries of opposition to protest the scrapping of regional languages in the UPSC exam, there appeared for once an amazing unanimity over not the reasons, but the need for opposition. The order annoyed state representatives from Tamil Nadu, Odisha, Maharashtra, West Bengal, and Punjab, who found Hindi hegemonic, whereas representatives from the Hindi heartland were annoyed at the hegemony of English. Gujarat Chief Minister Narendra Modi sought to reverse the changes by terming this as a language bias. In his letter to the PM, he says, the decision would ruin the dreams of thousands of candidates from Gujarat. A candidate will not be able to write the essay in Gujarati or any other language. He has now to compulsorily write it in English or in Hindi, unquote. Many MPs opposed English on the grounds of it being excluding an elitist language and therefore unfair to underprivileged sections of the society. Modi, however, for reasons I need not illustrate, got far more attention than the rest. And he says, and I find it sort of interesting to ask as to the tribals whom he seeks to represent, or the states he seeks to represent, it may be useful to ask why would those tribals be studying in the Gujarati medium, and whether there isn't another form of colonization within Gujarat that marginalizes tribal languages and presumes them to be Gujarati speaking and Gujarati studying. It's beyond my scope today to discuss whether the formation of linguistic states has helped or hindered the growth and legitimacy of Indian languages. Once again, work that has been done with Sudha Pai, Asha Sarangi, and earlier you've got Ambedkar's document on the linguistic states delineating some of the difficulties. But perhaps even this question that I'm asking is a wrong one, for it frames the issue in a polarized manner, and chances are that while the growth of the dominant language is fueled, the minority languages may have had to struggle, or that minority languages may benefit from tokenism, but emptied of real purposes of survival, as the case with Sindhi that I've noted elsewhere. The linguistic state of Gujarat does not have an easy relationship with languages other than Gujarati, and a glimpse of recent exchanges between Urdu schools and state government shows a particularly fractious and hostile view. And if there is time, I'll share with you this part of the work, which is not there in the paper right now. My concern is to continue with the observation that the formation of the linguistic state, along with Grierson's classification and Munshi's nationalism, consolidated the edifice of Gujarati. And then you would be aware of the contentious issue of the Dangs, of the Dangi, and whether Dangi belongs to Marathi or whether it belongs to Gujarati, and so on. Historical records were digged up. Historical record of the princely Vazda state and the Dongs were presented in the 1951 constitution of the Mahagujarat Seema Samiti that was held in Gujarat around 22nd December. And the records showed that this was Vasudevpur of the medieval times in the 20th century, and that it was a very prosperous region at the time of the Chalukyas. So what is decided is the Bhili Boli of Vazda belonged to the family of Gujarati, and Sanyukta Maharashtra Samiti was forcing its relation with Marathi. So I'm quoting here from the documents of the linguistic state. And it was decided that language cannot therefore be the only consideration. However, if it comes to separating Gujarati from Dangi, Gujarati and Marathi, it is possible that there are more words from Gujarati than there are from Marathi. It's a different matter that when you actually look at the relationship of mutual comprehensibility between Gujarati and Dangi, it's almost non-existent. So basically, it is in this context that the committee rallying around the linguistic state explains how Marathi words entered and so on and so forth. I'm very curiously drawn now to the employment of these arguments, to these rhetorical construction by which you will separate words, you separate grammar from vocabulary, sentence construction from the verb and from the auxiliary verb to decide what these territories are. And you see people getting down to that kind of nitty-gritty where there is no composite sense of what we are dealing with here. The three moments are indicative but demonstrate a range of nation-making processes. In Munshi's account, Gujarat appears as a nation that is natural and objective, organic, in a way that Herder and later Fichte propagated. The complete neglect of Arabic, Persian and Gujri in Munshi as well as Grierson, the reduction of encounter with the Arab world to a dismissive sentence or two, helped create an idea of Gujarati as a language of the Hindus, starting from Narsingh Mehta to Munshi himself in the 20th century. This forgetting, as Ernest Renard reminds us, is like those Yavani words in Bhadram Bhadra. It's never entirely about language, but an illegitimacy granted to a particular period, people, language, in history. Renard mentions that the essence of a nation is that all its individuals have many things in common, and also that they have forgotten many things. The forgetting extends to popular imagination as well as everyday interactions. So this next section is called Persisting Memories, Arabic, Persian, Gujarati and Gujari. Listening to a news on a perfectly ordinary day on the radio, I noticed the announcer say, "Emni same kanuni karyavahi karvama avi." It is quite likely that she may have not known that words such as kanuni and karyavahi come to Gujarat from its Perso-Arabic history that lasted over 3 centuries and created a repository of knowledge and institutions which find no mention in Grierson or Munshi. The episode of the past lingers in the language like sign without signification. In the midst of linguistic and historical pluralism, the Gujarat experience appears to be monolingual and monocultural. Yagnik and Sheth mentioned how during the Chalukya era on the foundation of Sanskrit, Prakrit and Apabhransh, Gujarati acquired its distinct character in the Sultanate area and so on. The influence of Persian and Arabic is immense. By the way, the announcer then concludes the news item that I was listening to on the radio by mentioning Gujarat government's support for a cultural heritage day, Sanskritik Varso Divas. Encapsulated in those terms, the cultural heritage story in Gujarat has no place for Arabic and Persian. Most people, including teachers, columnists, writers, are likely to be oblivious that the city of Ahmedabad has one of the most renowned library of Persian texts in the world. Scholars in recent times such as Sunil Sharma, Suchitra Balasubramanian, Achyut Yagnik, and in a more detailed way, Samira Sheikh, they have all drawn our attention to this neglected history. And they have drawn from a previous set of scholars working with Arabic and Persian, such as Ziauddin Desai, Chotubhai Nayak, M.A. Qureshi, Professor Bombaywala, Tirmizi, and so on. But believe me, this is not a part of popular imagination or even the literary circles at all, which I'll come to in a little while. So the productive exchanges on issues of theology, astronomy, literature between scholars from Shiraz, Baghdad and other places that take place in Gujarat and that find evidence, let's say, in the Pir Mohammad Shah Library remain sort of completely unknown. As to what this history goes back to is well known. It goes back to the trade period and so on, and I'm not sort of going to talk about that right now. But let me sort of come to... have I overshot? I'm just about in time. So the linguistic cosmopolitanism and literary energy fueled by the state, when you had Ahmad Shah and Mohammad Begra and the Sultans of Gujarat inviting scholars, really speaking, appears now like a world lost to the hyper-industrialized and application-oriented Gujarat today. Meanwhile, the Gujarat Sultanate era produced many scholars in Persian and drew writers even from the upper castes, Hindus, Muslim elites and Parsis. Names even in today among Gujarati Hindus such as Ghare Khan, Mohammad Makad, carry vestiges of a period when, as I discovered even in the case of Sindhi, donning clothes, language, accent of the Muslim elite was considered aspirational for some upper caste groups in Gujarat. My generation witnessed the waning of Persian, bade goodbye to some of its teachers who do not have successors. The Sindhi medium school my siblings studied in had a mandatory course in Persian. Both Sindhi and Persian could not survive an ethos in which those languages were made bereft of purpose. However, Gujarat's historical relation with West Asia has remnants in words not only from Persian and Arabic, but also Turkish and Sindhi. In fact, the 15th century witnessed the emergence of Gujri, which had elements of all these. You may remember, and let me simply summarize this particular section, you may remember from 2002 riots about the tomb of Wali Gujarati, which was desecrated. This is, Wali Gujarati came as a culmination of Gujarati, of Gujri Bhasha. Or some people call it Gujari Boli. Some call it the lingua franca. We do not know exactly what its extent was. We do not know to what, whether it sort of moved beyond the region of Ahmedabad and its surroundings and so forth. But what we do know is that there is a fair amount of corpus of poetry, utterances of the peers and sovereigns written in what is considered by historians of that period as Gujri, and Walli is really the culmination of that period. But neither Walli's name nor any familiarity with Gujri exist in the literary circles in Gujarat. So when this episode happened in 2002 and there was news coverage and there was outrage by literary scholars largely outside Gujarat and meetings happened, for a little while you saw references to this, but believe me, they disappeared once again. So that even in the course of working on this research, when I go to places like Sahitya Parishad and I say, you know, do you have anything on Gujari? It's not a name that's familiar. They said, oh, Gujari shu charita ben, Gujari bajar che. There is no reference at all. You look at Sarth Jorani Kosh, that took place under Gandhi's direction, and you see Gujari as Striye Perulu Perilu Abhushar, jewelry worn by women, or Kasbo, or Bazaar. Right? So there is no familiarity. It's almost as if that entire history either does not exist or it exists in a different quarter altogether. And therefore, I'm sort of led to ask this question. Is the schism between Hindu and Muslim literary histories played out on languages, or are languages polarizing? Do these trajectories and perceptions of language tell us how old such schisms are? Or are they blurred in the mixture of languages? Has Gujari disappeared, lost, like River Saraswati, or morphed into standard forms of some other language like Gujarati or Urdu? It's beyond the scope of today's talk to delve further into these questions that demand a detailed treatment of their own. Meanwhile, a forgetting people had been reminded of what they had forgotten. However, lack of reflection and will contained even this episode, so that it found no mention or discussion in subsequent events in Gujarat, including the recent festival I mentioned. The domain of the popular culture illustrated through the festival and radio announcements seek analysis of the national publics. How the nation is represented, how its aspirations are authorized, and how its claims and origins are narrated. The mainstream literary establishment, as well as general Gujarati-speaking person, is almost completely oblivious of how once upon a time, speaking and writing in Persian was also a way of being Gujarati, especially in the Nagar community, and how the same community contributed the most to the consolidation of what is now Gujarati language and literature. Little known is the fact that until the early and almost mid-20th century, synonymies assumed between religion and language were not made, so that the predominantly Hindu presence in Gujarati literary events would not have happened without the co-presence of Muslim and Parsi writers, even up to the early 20th century. Little discussed is the fact that dimensions of time, space, and simultaneity complicate the seamlessness of the Gujarati story in popular imagination. The fact that at the time of codifying Gujarati in the Linguistic Survey of India, Grierson had to, somewhat unconvincingly even to himself, separate Gujarati from Marwari in the north, or that determinability of Dangi as a relation of Gujarati rather than Marathi gave the advocates of the linguistic state a challenge, or the fact that it is impossible to speak four continuous sentences of Gujarati without making use of words with Perso-Arabic origin, or that the lesser known histories mention Gujari as a lingua franca in the 15th and 16th century, disrupting the standard narrative of Gujarati, all this remains unknown. My paper ends with uncovering false certitudes with which languages are imagined as sources of a regional identity, a contestable entity, and positioned as counter-voice to the onslaught of globalization. In fact, technologies of globalization consolidate the Matrubhasha campaigns experienced uncritically by a few on behalf of a large collectivity. Meanwhile, forms of linguistic plurality in quotidian contexts may have a set of configurations that the paper has not taken account of. An evolving linguistic sphere in which an increasing use of Urdu by Muslims, Sanskritized Gujarati by Hindus, represent extreme polarities of one kind, while the Gujaratification of Kachhi, the abdication of Sindhi, and other tribal languages may represent different points of the spectrum. Resisting the coherent narrative of language and history are also Gujaratis that continue to be spoken and used, serving as indices of self-expression as well as identification. It has not been my attempt to provide these lived practices of language given the scope of today's paper. However, I hope that the need to move away from studying language as disembodied, away from people, has been sufficiently contested and some unfreezing of synonymies between languages and identity made. The exercise is far from complete, but it may still have resonances in other parts of India and the world, wherever communities choose a particular version of language to imagine the past as well as the present. To sort of bring it all together very briefly, these are the larger questions that I'm finding my way through, that I'm feeling my way through, and which is that we need to complicate the idea of multilingualism and see multilingualism in the crisscrossings and relations rather than a static fact of languages being positioned next to each other and celebrate. While there may be a lot to celebrate, that's not the question here. But the point is, I think there is a very static understanding of multilingualism because we think of language as these isomorphs sitting next to each other through these various regions, and that's the zone that I sort of wish to go into. I'm also sort of arguing for bringing language center stage in scholarship that's engaged with identity and cultural history. Finally, the discipline that I come from, or the work that I mostly do within the arena of translation studies, I do believe very strongly that we need to bring language back in some sense into discussions of translation. We moved away too easily thinking linguistic descriptions of translation are reductive, and yes, they can be, but I think it's translation studies, the idea of a text, of a source, of a binary, all these are built on certitudes that we haven't really questioned. I think we need to do some unlearning or going back. Finally, I think it's a truism really to say, and Wanda say, that language evolves and is dynamic and so on. And we hold that as a position, as a counter voice to purism. But I think we also need to hold that to history writing. Thank you very much.